Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
What I'd like to do tonight is put something in your heart that's really going to make you happy. So if you don't want to be happy, you can leave now. You know, I want to share with you some imagery of heaven. I want to share with you a little picture, a little view of heaven. Because I'm assuming you want to go to heaven. How many of you want to go to heaven? Yeah, about half of you. That's wonderful. You know, I want to go to heaven. I just don't want to go tonight. Do you? I don't want to go tomorrow. I don't want to go this week. I don't want to go next week. In other words, I want to live the full length of my days. But when my body is exhausted and I've lived out the dreams God put in my heart, thank God for that day to be absent from my body and present with the Lord. But have you ever really thought about what it's going to be like? See, Jesus, when he taught the disciples to pray, he said, you can pray that God's will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. I want to give you a picture of heaven that's a little different, a little distinctive. It may shock you. It may put you in awe. But I want to do it for one reason, so you can transfer what we see tonight in heaven to your earthly arena. So you can transfer tonight to your home. You can transfer it tomorrow to your workplace. You can transfer it tomorrow to the traffic jam on the 10 freeway or whatever. In other words, I want to show you a little bit of imagery of heaven. So what I'm going to do is play you a video by reading the scripture. It's not going to be a video you see on the screen. It's going to be a video you have to use your imagination with. God gave you an imagination so you could really, really dream the way he wants you to dream and think the way he wants you to think. So go with me, please, in your Bible to Revelation chapter 5. Actually, Revelation chapter 4 and 5. Is giving you some imagery of heaven. You know, when you think about what Jesus did on the cross, in fact, we sang a song tonight, you know, the one with the part of the lyrics of the amazing grace, you know, and what God has done, and then, you know, looking to Jesus and looking to his eyes and seeing his love, or the lyrics were something like that. It's what will it be like for you and me on that day when we leave this environment, we step into the heavenly realm? Remember that song written a few years ago, I Can Only Imagine What It Would Be Like. But let's, as I read this and unveil it, let's pretend that we're in that company in heaven around the throne of God. And let's say we're standing back at it. I'd just be grateful to be there. You know, it's going to be astonishing. But what do you think it'll be like? You know, in heaven, they're around the throne of God, but the attention of everyone in heaven is on the Lamb of God. The love of the Lamb of God still astonishes everyone and everything in heaven. It's overwhelmingly good news. And so everybody's around heaven. You know, the Bible says that love was demonstrated at the cross. God demonstrated his love for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In other words, at the cross, love was demonstrated and displayed. In that love act, influenced and affected everything, everywhere. The book of Colossians says that God has reconciled all things, things in heaven, things in the earth, and things under the earth. Now, how do you explain that to anybody with understanding? It's a mystery. See, the love of God is such a massive mystery that even when you step into heaven, you're not going to fully get it. Do you know the scripture says, Paul the Apostle says, that God is going to make known to us the manifold riches of his grace in the ages to come. When we step out of a time zone into a timeless zone, Paul used a time zone to describe the massive reality of the love of the Father. It's going to take ages for you and me to absorb the beauty of what God has done for us in Christ. And so they're all around heaven, created beings, angelic beings, the elders, human beings, They're all around the throne of God. And look at the writer says in Revelation chapter 5, verse 9. It says, and they sang a new song, saying, Jesus, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain. Speaking of the cross. For you were slain, and you have redeemed us to God by your blood. Now let's pause right here for a minute. That word redeemed is an old English word. In the newer translations, they translate it purchased. See, in our culture, see, we live in a merit-based culture. Our culture is based on what you do for you to get good, you do good kind of thing. In other words, and that's fine. Along this environment, you know, for example, the American dream that everybody talks about, it's based on merit. They say, if you work hard, if you play by the rules, you can move up and get ahead in life. Isn't that what they tell us? How many know that's not totally the truth? Because the world is set up with corrupt governments, corrupt businesses, corrupt human beings, right? So merit-based mindsets don't always work. But what happens many times is we take a merit-based mindset into a relationship with the Father, which is an unmerited-based system. It's based on the work of one, Jesus Christ, that's influenced all of us. And so it's interesting to me that they use this term to redeem. He has redeemed us, or he has purchased us to God by his blood. Then it says, out of every tribe, every tongue, every people, and every nation. This to me is a great missions message because it shows you the influence of the radical love of God, that God has purchased us in Christ. Everyone, everywhere has been included. And so we have to announce the news in the way people can believe it and receive it and swallow it. See, the love of God is astonishing. And so we've been purchased and it's a done deal. In other words, no more payments are required. And that's why that term purchased or redeemed. You know, Heidi, she was telling me she has grandkids tonight, or granddaughters. And so that's why she's not with me. In fact, they're having a sleepover at Granny's house. And I will come to the rescue in about 3 hours to help Granny with the grandkids. But anyway, she yesterday went to the mall and she bought little outfits. She was telling me this morning as I got up and was doing some things before I went to the office. She went to the mall yesterday, but she says, oh, Keith, now, there were some great sales, Keith. I mean, it was just really amazing. 40% off, then I had this coupon and this. She told me, because she's getting ready to unload all these things that she purchased. But Heidi didn't come to me and say, Keith, look at these outfits. This is what I redeemed. No, she says, this is what we've purchased. But we use the term purchase very loosely in our culture because we say we purchase something before we fully pay for something. Yeah. So what we do is we always have payments on our mind. Yeah. That's why people who use credit cards and only pay the minimal payment, they've never really paid for their suit. Yeah. They're always making payments. People buy bigger ticket items. You know, now I heard yesterday in the news, the auto industry has just boomed. This is like a banner month, a banner year, a banner everything, because their interest is low. And so now you can buy a car. You see these commercials on TV. You can buy a vehicle. Let's say I went and bought a brand new truck. And I got it all loaded and everything, and it was $45,000. And I drove it into the parking lot tonight and got out of it, and somebody said to me, wow, Keith, that's a pretty nice truck. And I said, I just purchased it. Now, that person might think, oh, Keith's loaded. I knew he was a big-time minister. I knew he had a lot of money. I bet he paid cash. So we come into the church and the person is thinking back in the chair, wow, Keith is really loaded. He comes across like he's not loaded, but he purchased a brand new loaded truck. I knew that guy had a lot of money. That's the way people think. But I could be preaching to the guy and thinking, my goodness, I just purchased a truck, but it's the first of the month. What's the first of the month mean? A payment is due. See, people in our culture, merit-based-minded people, always have payments on their mind. And they think they're standing For a peace point is based on their payment. And so if I bought a truck, for example, and didn't make a few payments, you know what? Somebody would come and repossess what I purchased because what I purchased wasn't really mine. It was the bank's. And so Jesus, according to the heavenly picture, has purchased us to God. By his blood, everyone, everywhere. And so somehow we have to announce the news. And then it goes on the next verse. It says, and he's made us kings and priests. Sometimes if you live with a merit-based mindset, you always have ongoing payments on your mind. I remember when I first signed up to be a Christian, I yielded my heart to Jesus. I confessed my sins. I repented. I went toward the Lord. But I still wasn't fully secure in the work of Jesus. I still was subconsciously, I always was trying to justify me. Religion sometimes will always make you want to pay. And sometimes it's with guilt or shame or condemnation or effort or doing this or doing that or doing it harder. There's this one lady when I'm preaching in America. A great church, beautiful people, but this one lady and her husband, after I preach, I like to hang out with the people, hug people, give people high fives and stuff like that. And people sometimes come up for prayer. This lady always comes up to me for prayer. And I'm very patient with her. She tells me all of her problems with her husband, all of her problems with her kids, all her problems with the grandkids. And I said, precious one, listen, Jesus is enough for you. Let me pray for you. Let's give all this stuff to the Lord. So I pray and I pray over these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And as soon as I'm done, she grabs my arm and she says, oh, Keith, pray harder. Pray harder. Pray harder. Have you ever felt you didn't do something hard enough or something and you felt insecure in yourself? It's kind of the thought sometimes that can rob you of the joy of what Jesus has done for you. And so what I want to show you tonight from heaven is there's a beauty about the truth, no matter the good, the bad, and the ugly that happens in life. The truth of the matter is, before the Father in Christ, you are purchased by the blood of the Lamb. And you're good to God. Your faith in Jesus has secured you. And you don't always have to live with payments on your mind or add-ons. You are good to God because of the Lamb and the Lamb alone. Jesus has paid you in full in relation to the reality of your righteousness and your peace and your joy and your provision, your sanctification, your contentment, your fulfillment, your everything. Jesus is your all in all. And that's a peace point. That's good news. Give the Lord a shout, somebody. Amen. Jesus is your all in all. You're good to God because of the Lamb. I always use kind of silly, simple illustrations because I'm just a simple, silly gospel preacher. But I always remind myself, and I do it to this day, that my standing before the Father is not dependent on me. My standing before the Father is dependent on my faith in Jesus. Faith moves you out of yourself into himself. Faith gets you out of your sufficiency to his sufficiency. Faith is the delivering power to deliver you from you. See, people who are always making payments really never enjoy their own company. They're always nervous. They're always agitated about themselves in some qualifying sense. Jesus has pre-approved us. And this is the beauty about the blood. So faith allows you to enjoy what Jesus has done, and God sees you in Christ. Jesus now becomes God's opinion of you. And it's an amazing thing to renew your mind to the thought that I'm good to God because of the Lamb. So think about it in our little video. We're all surrounding the throne of God, but nobody's looking to God. Not in that little video clip. They're looking to the Lamb of God. And they're astonished at the love of the Lamb. They're saying, you got to be kidding me. Reconcile. Out of every nation, tribe, tongue, and kindred. It's astonishing. And so this is good news that we're paid in full. Let me show you a couple of things that'll just refresh you. I'm going to show you tonight three things how you can know you're purchased. All right. How you can know it's a done deal. How you can know you're good to God because of the Lamb. And all you need to do is by faith cooperate. and learn to behold the Lamb and walk with Him and let His nature be displayed through your life. Number one, first thing to help you understand that you have been purchased by God. Number one is this: God has signed for you. God has signed for you. Do you notice, have you ever gotten a delivery at your home or something? This is Christmas season and, you know, people send packages and things. We get packages, you know, when I'm at Life Center USA, at the U.S. office, you know, almost every day, UPS, FedEx, somebody's delivering something. And I went out the administrative door some months ago, and the UPS guy was out front. It's a busy street, big busy intersection. And he had all these boxes out on the sidewalk. And I walked out there, and he said, hey, sir, do you know where I take all this stuff? And I said, well, friend, usually they have the deliveries all in the back. There's a back alley, and the people there take it and put it in. But since it's all out, just take it inside, take it into the gymnasium, and leave it there. So I said, I'll even help you carry this stuff. He said, you'd help me? I said, sure, I got nothing better to do. So I helped him get all the boxes and carried them all in. As soon as we had all the boxes stacked up in there, he brings out his little electronic pad and said, would you sign for them? I said, sure. So you use your finger, right? It's like the finger of God. You're writing. I put my signature, which nobody can read. And he looks at it and he says, what's your name? I said, Hershey, like the Hershey bar. He said, thank you, Mr. Hershey. He said, I want you to know these packages are out of my hands and they're into your hands. And he left. I want you to know when Jesus Christ went to the cross, from God's point of view, God signed for you with the blood of the Lamb, and you are in the hands of a loving Father. He's got you. He holds you when you don't even know how to hold on to Him. He's always at work. Where can you go? You can't escape the penetrating love of God in Christ. God has signed for you. Look at the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and verse 19, says this, knowing, everybody say knowing.
Knowing.
Now that's not like a head knowledge knowing, that's like a gut knowing. See, you can know something in your head, never get nowhere with it. But when you know something in your gut, deep in your spirit. See, everything I've ever attempted to do in ministry in terms of cooperating with the Lord wasn't a head idea. It was something that absolutely captured my spirit. And I had no option. It was a gut knowing. Because it's crazy. And people try to talk me out of many things that we've done. You know, even recently, the last year and a half, the last 2 years, been like the most challenging time in my life. Sometimes I want to look at myself in the mirror and just slap me for me. You know what I mean? Because sometimes you look at the challenges of life, but you have to know something. Knowing that you were not purchased. Not redeemed, purchased with corruptible things like silver and gold. What's silver and gold? That's a merit-based economy. That's what your effort provides. That's what everybody chases. Silver and gold from your aimless conduct received by the tradition of your fathers. How many of you have some aimless conduct that you receive from your family tree? Yeah, from your genealogy. Man, I'm from a long line of rascals, right? I received it from my fathers. Look what it says in verse 19. But with the precious blood of Christ. I was purchased, I was signed for with the blood of Jesus as a lamb without blemish and without spot. What's that a reference to? The cross. You'll notice that every verse I share tonight in what I'm going to talk to you about is woven into the reality of the Lamb of God at the cross. You're purchased with the currency that the Father uses, the blood of the Lamb. Do you know the currency of the kingdom technically is not even your faith? The blood did the work. The currency of the Father's kingdom is the blood of the Lamb. Now, faith allows you to enjoy what the blood provided. But the blood did the work. See, it's all on Jesus. It's on all on what, and I tell you, when your heart gets absolutely gripped with the love of the Lamb of God, you say, you've got to be kidding me. Now it's easier to step in by faith and enjoy what He's done because you don't have to make a payment for it. He's not going to sell you short. He did the whole thing. From start to finish, you are good to God because of Jesus. Give the Lord a shout, somebody. Hallelujah. It's good news. So God has signed for you. Number one. Number two, God has sealed you. You are signed and you are sealed. You know what a seal is? A seal is like a stamp of approval. In the old days when the kings would have a ring and they would give a seal of approval. We all like approval, don't we? We all like likes on Facebook. Huh? We like people to validate us in all the social media platforms. We like to be liked. Our flesh craves it. Nothing wrong with it. My flesh, I still prefer to be liked over hated. When I started in ministry 33 years ago with Heidi, I was broke. Our first year of marriage, we lived in Africa and came back to America and started Mutual Faith. I had enough money. I bought a car for $3,600 and I drove around America for 6 months. And I said, God, let somebody know I'm carrying something. And Father, help him to draw it out of me. I was scared, you know. But in those days, I so wanted somebody to like me. I craved a pastor giving me a recommendation. Now, thank God, God was merciful to us, and people like your wonderful founding pastors came into our lives and others that helped us through all these years. But even to this day, I still like to be liked. But you know what? Man-made approval really isn't quite as important to me now. I like the endorsement from heaven. I like the Father's favor. I like the unending love of God, because everybody doesn't always understand decisions you make and what you do or how you communicate or whatever. And I've learned in life that I've got to rest in the love of the Father and understand that God has sealed me. I have heaven's stamp of approval. It's better than good housekeeping. It's better than the Food Network. It's better than ESPN. Listen, I have heaven's endorsement. You know how I know it? I only know it by faith. And this is what I know by Ephesians 1, verse 13. The Bible says, in him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth. See, this is why somebody's got to be a proclaimer. Somebody's got to be a preacher. The gospel of salvation, in whom also having believed. See, somebody's got to tell you the truth that you accepted so you can believe it. Some of you folk tonight need to believe what Jesus has done. So you've got to be kidding. And have an astonishing understanding and step into the reality of the new creation. Be born again. But you have to believe it. And it says, if when you believe it, you were sealed with the Spirit upon you. You know, when the Spirit comes in your spirit and you're one spirit with the Lord, it's a mystery. How does your human mind get around it? It's the mystery hidden from the ages. Christ in you. You're sealed with the Spirit of promise. It's beautiful. You are signed and you are sealed. And I tell you, when the Spirit of God comes in you, he comes to stay. He doesn't come to go. He's not as fickle as we are. He comes to stay. And I tell you what, when you have that kind of confidence, because you're not always going to have a perfect day in the flesh. How many can say amen to that? Amen. You know, you're housed in this flesh cage and sin is in the flesh. Your spirit is holy unto the Lord. But I tell you one thing, even on the days when I've been so disappointed, so angry, you know, y'all think I'm just a nice guy. But this brother, man, I've gone through so many challenges in the last year where I absolutely lost it. I know none of you are like that. That's why I like you all so much. You have such great disciplines. You know what I do in my weakness? I behold the Lamb of God who restores, who heals, who equips. And he does the same for you. Amen. He comes to stay. God has signed for you. God has sealed you. Number three, real quick, God has delivered you. You are signed. You are sealed. You are delivered. I'm yours. Remember the old Motown song, huh? Who? That's your new confession now. You look in the mirror tomorrow and say, hey, good looking, listen up now. You are signed, you are sealed, you are delivered. I'm yours. This is what they're astonished with in heaven even now. The love of the Lamb of God. It's past figuring out. He sealed you. And he delivered you. No, he delivered you. Look at it. It says in Galatians 1, verse 3 and 4. It says, grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. And again, notice the verses. All a reference to the cross. What Jesus has done. He gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of our God and Father. People always say, Keith, what's the will of God for me? Well, there's a lot of little ways to find out parts of it. This verse says the will of God for you is to know you're delivered. You're delivered from the influence and the effects of this evil age. How many know we live in a cesspool? We're in this system, but we're not of it. See, you don't have to yield your members to the filth and the nonsense in the sin of the world. If you're beholding the Lamb of God, your victory over your flesh is to understand Jesus has delivered you from it. You never have to yield your members to it. It never has to triumph. There's a place for you in Christ because you are delivered. Now, it doesn't say you have to really go look for your deliverance. You have to believe you are delivered. So you can work out of you what God already's got in you. You're delivered. The Bible teaches you're delivered from sin. The book of Romans chapter 6 says you're delivered from the power of darkness. Colossians chapter 1. So many things would go on and on and on. But you have to know, you have to believe, no matter what addiction, what problem, what torment, what mental anguish, what frustration, you're delivered. And there's a way to behold the Lamb and work out the reality of that salvation. And part of the word salvation means deliverance. Why? Because you're purchased. Heaven knows it. You ought to know it in the earth. You ought to believe it in the earth, and you ought to be astonished with it. You're delivered. When you know this kind of radical love, that you've been purchased by God, you can change the way you think. And this will actually help you change the way you live. You know how this gospel preacher gets more transformation in my flesh life? It's not by trying to be better. It's by beholding the Lamb and knowing I'm purchased and then having a corresponding action with his life. Look at the scripture says. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20. Says, for you were purchased or bought, purchased with a price. Therefore, because you know you're purchased, therefore glorify God in your body, that's your flesh life, and in your spirit, that's your spiritual life, which are God's. Yes. See, the way my flesh life can get better victories is to know I'm purchased. Yes. But if I believe I've got to make a payment to be good enough to think I'm in, you'll never have a confidence in you. You're just not that well equipped. None of us are. We have to believe that Jesus pre-approved us, and now we renew our mind by beholding the Lamb, just like they're doing in heaven. And when we know that, therefore, we change in our body and in our spirit, which are God's. And this is the beautiful thing, friend. We should respond with the beauty of what Jesus has done and believe we are purchased. There's no ands, no ifs, no buts about it. I'm good to God because of Jesus. And if I can just radically rest in his love for me and behold what he's done and cooperate with his nature in me, his character in me, his word that I'm learning and growing in, I will live in accordance with his character and have victories in this merit-based world. Because sin has a great, great penalty and great, great judgment in this life. Anytime you yield your members that way. So how do you respond to such astonishing good news? Let's go back to our little video. Let's go back to Revelation 5. Let me have you use your imagination again. Revelation chapter 5, we're going to read the last verse. We read verses 9 and 10. Now let's look at verse 14. It says, this is the last verse in that chapter, by the way. It says, then the four living creatures said, amen. Let me hear you all say amen.
Amen.
Now let me hear you say like you mean. Say amen.
Amen.
Now notice the response in heaven's pretty simple. Now think with me now. This is the heavenly picture. They all just said amen. They're around the throne of the Lamb. The conclusion of the matter is just an amen. And then it says, then the 24 elders fell down. People say, Keith, did they fall in the Spirit? I don't know. Did they sit? Did they fall? Did they, rest? I don't know. But to me, to be down is a rested environment. It's a peaceful place. They fell down. They worshiped Him who lives forever and ever. You know the conclusion of the matter of beholding the Lamb of God who's purchased everyone everywhere? You know the conclusion of the matter was they had nothing else to say. Have you ever struggled trying to pray and say something? You know, people look at me and they say, well, Keith, you're just a natural talker. You just have a gift to speak. No, friend, no. I'm the biggest loser when it comes to having anything to say. I'm an introvert. I was afraid to speak. I never could be before people. When I was a senior in university at Azusa Pacific, I was 21 years old in a speech class. I vibrated up there, the whole thing, my knees, my whole body. The teacher came afterwards, thought I was going to drop dead. She said, you okay? I said, yeah, I'm okay. I have nothing, no gift. But you know, when Jesus got a hold of my heart and said, Keith, I'm going to raise you up and I'm going to send you to the nations. I said, I can't speak. But you know what? God takes my weakness and makes it my strength. God uses losers like me. There's hope for all of us because God thrives in taking our weaknesses and showing off the beauty of His great love. Amen. It says the four living creatures said amen. Have you ever gone to a prayer meeting? I remember years ago they had the could you not tarry 1 hour prayer meetings. And I used to go out of guilt because I was in the ministry. So I'd go and it was in a church that had pews and I would kneel down at 5 a.m. I think, man, you know, and then I'd pray all my confessions. I'd pray New Testament prayers, read them out of the scriptures, you know, Ephesians 1. I'd pray for the leaders. I'd pray for the nations. I'd pray in the Spirit when I ran out of the English, which was pretty quick. You know, I'd run out. Thank God I could pray in the Spirit. And then I'd pray and pray and pray. And some days it was like God equipped me to pray, and it was beautiful. But sometimes I prayed everything I knew, you know, and I looked at my watch, and 5 minutes had passed. You know what I mean? Have you ever had that? Like, man, what am I going to do now? Have you ever suffered like that? I used to always feel so guilty because I couldn't pray good. I wasn't really a professional prayer. So people say, Keith, you know, sometimes people say, oh, Keith, you must pray hours. Well, I really don't at one time, but I pray all the time. I like Smith Wigglesworth. He said, it's very seldom I go 15 minutes without communing with the Lord. In other words, I don't pray long at one time, but there's always a connecting point. And that's a little bit like my life. But what I like about the heavenly picture, after you're astonished at the Lamb of God and you can believe it and receive this kind of absolute beauty, which changes the equation for everything. And if you can absolutely glimpse the glory of what the Lamb has done, sometimes you can just sit down and say amen. You know, right now I've had so many challenges that I don't even know how to pray. I've had so many challenges in this last year and a half, I don't know how to pray at times. You know what I've learned through God teaching me? That I can just sit under a tree. I can pull my car down a dirt road when I'm traveling preaching. And sit under a tree or go to a park and say, God, I don't have a clue about what I'm to do. But I just behold the Lamb of God and I let God love me. And the conclusion of my fellowship is amen. You know what amen means? Cool. It means so be it. I'm paid in full according to the authority of heaven. Cool. I love the beauty of the simplicity of an amen. I take my granddaughters when they come visit me out on the hammock. I teach them to pray by looking at the stars. I say, look at the moon. I'm rocking in the hammock. I say, God loves us. God's going to take care of us. God's going to take care of you little girls. You don't need to worry about nothing. And then I teach them to say amen. Just say amen. Just say amen. I want you to know sometimes if you evaluate your life according to your flesh and you live in that mindset of merit-based, you will live always disappointed with you and you'll live disappointed with everybody around you. You have to live with the reality of what God's done for you in Christ and your position by faith in Him, which changes everything. Earlier this year, a great songwriter died. He wrote a lot of songs. Andre Crouch. When I was a young boy growing up in Michigan, this would be the late 60s, maybe 1970 or so, he wrote great, great songs, but he passed away. And his church, by the way, is like a minute and a half from Life Center USA. So the day he died, I drove by his church, and they had a little sign up. Andre was promoted to heaven. Some of you may know him, some of you may not, but he wrote songs like all kinds of different songs. One song he wrote was Through It All, Through It All. I learned to trust in Jesus. I learned to trust in God. Through it all, I learned to depend on His Word. He wrote songs like Jesus is the answer for the world today. Without Him, there's no other. Jesus is the way. He wrote songs, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. For the things He hath done with His blood. Da-da-dee-dee. He wrote songs like, I don't know why Jesus loved me. I don't know why He cared. I don't know why He sacrificed His life. Oh, but I'm glad. So glad He did. I still don't know why Jesus loves me. It astonishes me because I know me according to the flesh. But you know what? God in Christ loves me completely. Amen. Amen. And it's the same truth for you too. He wrote songs like, the blood will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain. It flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never, never, never lose its power. Huh? Great song. Then he wrote a song, because I was searching the internet after he died for his songs just to hear him again. And he wrote a song called Let the Church Say Amen. Let the church say amen, for God has spoken. Let the church say amen. Have you ever heard your pastors through this year? I heard Pastor Luke here just taught Pastor Luke here before I came up here. I said, I'm going to listen to your teaching Sunday because I've heard so many great comments about it. And both your new, you know, senior pastor and executive are phenomenal communicators. You are blessed. You are very blessed. But, you know, sometimes I hear people teach, and man, they're like beyond what I can do. I'm just a simple gospel preacher. But sometimes you hear people teach on angels and all kinds of stuff. And I just like listen and think, man. You know what my new thing is when I can't fully figure it out? Because I can't fully figure out hardly anything anymore. But you know what I can do? I can say amen to the love of the Father. I can say amen when people preach this astounding goodness of God's grace and what God's doing in the hearts and lives of people. And we can say amen to it. And amen is enough. Amen is enough. This is our response to the mystery of the cross. The mystery of God's love and God's acceptance to us is just say amen. Give the Lord a shout of praise. Amen. I'm out of time. I just looked at my watch. Praise the Lord. I was having such a good time. Did y'all enjoy tonight? Yeah. Give the Lord another shout. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Just stay seated if you can. Don't anybody move around. Just rest in the presence of the Lord. Put your hands on your heart. And let's just say this with me. Just everybody say this simple prayer. Say, Jesus, I receive your love. I take the heavenly pattern. And I behold the Lamb of God. And I just say amen. Father, I'm astonished at what you've done for me in Christ Jesus. Through the blood of the Lamb, he has purchased me. I'm good to God because of Jesus. I believe that. I receive your love. And I say amen to your goodness and grace. Thank you, Father. I am signed. I am sealed. I am delivered. And I am yours. I give you praise for what you're doing in me and what you're doing through me. I'm victorious in this life through Christ Jesus. Amen. Now give the Lord a shout of praise. Can you do that? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know what I'd like to do just very briefly tonight is give you a chance to have an amen moment publicly. You know, I told you there was a day that somebody presented the gospel to me. And I knew if I didn't receive the love of the Father, I was on my own. And when you're on your own, it's never going to look good. Not in this life or the life that is to come. There's a heaven to gain. There's a hell to shun. And I knew I could meet the mark of the righteousness, what God required. And so thank God I learned that Jesus has provided the righteousness on my behalf. And I could find myself before the Father, not in myself, but in Himself. So I remember the day I prayed a prayer and I stepped into Christ. Now it took a season of time, a few years actually, for Keith to renew his mind to the beauty of what Jesus has done. So I was a flesh Christian for many, many years until I really, really understood the strength of what God's Word and God's church, God's people would do for me. And so that's why it's important that you hang out with friends in faith, because you're not going to find faith-filled friends just running around the streets. You need to come where you're taught of the Lord, where you're faithful, where you're discipled, and God's a great love, His amazing grace, His tender mercies that are toward you. And so I like to invite people to have believing moments. You know, when I'm in the Middle East and I'm talking to all the Muslims, we have a 700-seat sanctuary there at Life Center in the Middle East, and it's full of Muslim people, and we present the gospel sometime with song, sometime with theater, sometimes through preaching, in so many different ways. But when we give the altar calls, invite people to have a believing moment, it just takes your heart being gripped with radical love to behold the Lamb and say yes to what Jesus has done. Don't trust in yourself, but to trust in Himself. Repent of your sin and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight, I want to see if you're bold enough to be a believer. I always tell people, if you're not bold enough to lift your hand in a church to follow Jesus, you'll never follow Jesus outside the church. So tonight, I want to give you a chance. Maybe you're visiting. Maybe you've been here before. Maybe you've run from God. Maybe you're just full of all kinds of shame and addictions and challenges and problems, and you think you're a loser in life. The love of God is greater than any pain point you'll ever experience. I can testify to that because I've had many, many pain points. And Jesus rescues us from them all. So what I'd like us to do with our heads up and our eyes open and everybody looking around, I want to see if the love of God has astonished you enough to put your faith in Jesus. I want to see if you can put your trust in Him before others. Jesus said, if you would just acknowledge me before others, before men, I will acknowledge you before the Father in heaven. And I believe there's a beautiful thing that Jesus has you as a testimony on His lips because you've chosen to have Him as a testimony on your lips. So tonight, what I'm going to do is do what Pastor Jim does. I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to ask you if you'd like a prayer to step out of yourself into Himself, out of self-sufficiency into the sufficiency of Jesus, out of sin into righteousness. If you say, Keith, I want to make that exchange. I want to give myself wholeheartedly to the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to receive His love so I can love Him in return wholeheartedly. You know, your love for the Father, you don't have to work it up. It's just a reciprocal. See, in my daily living, I just take time to be loved, and then my love for Him is just a natural response. I'm not signing you up for any works. I'm not signing you up for any things to try to make you feel you got to make enough payments to be accepted. I want you to know you are accepted as you are and not as you need to be. Just come on into the family of God and everything about your life can change. So if you say, Keith, man, that sounds like something I desperately need. I want to commit my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to be born again. I want to forsake my sin. I want to live unto righteousness. I want to give my life to Jesus. With our heads up, our eyes open, and everybody looking around, if you want this prayer on the count of three, just raise your hand. Would you do that for me, please? One, two, three. Raise your hand. Thank you, my friend. Thank you, my friend. Thank you, my friend. Thank you, my friend. Any other people? Praise the Lord. Those of you with your hands raised, would you just stand to your feet real quick? Just stand to your feet. Just come on down real quick. I want to shake your hand. Who else? Real quick. There's got to be some more folk. Anybody else say, Keith, I want this prayer. I want this prayer. Anybody over here? Jesus, I love you. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Jesus, I love you. Hallelujah. My brother, you're blessed. Best day of your life. My precious sister, you're blessed. The best day of your life. My beloved sister, the best day of your life. My brother, the best day of your life. My brother, the best day of your life. Come on down. Who else? Here we go. Here's a couple more. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Hey, my brother, you're blessed. Best day of your life. You're blessed, my dear.
Thank you.
The best day of your life. Come on down. Anybody else? Hallelujah. You know what? You guys are really bold. You know what I love about this? See, Jesus takes shame off of us. He puts righteousness in us. And God sees you in Christ, so Jesus is God's opinion of you. It's hard to think because you only know yourself according to your flesh. God knows you according to your redeemed spirit. It's a beautiful thing. He doesn't know us according to our flesh. That's why we're to know Jesus, not according to the flesh, but according to what He's done, His death, His risenness. It's beautiful. He's triumphed everything. Our pastor brother here is going to just take a couple minutes with you. So just turn. Just go just for a minute or two for some prayer. Give him a hand. Can you do that? Pastor, come.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent Him for me. And then He died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that His blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.